tester.co.uk.
Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this T4D. Now, as noted in the title, this is probably going to be the last T4D for a little while. And that's probably a good thing because I finally got to the point where my lab is set up. It's kind of in a more functional state. I've got a lot of equipment and kit now to get down to doing either tutorials, fun projects, and equipment reviews. So there's a whole lot of kit which is piled up, and it's now time to kind of get head down and jump into that. So that's why for the time being, we'll kind of slow up on the T4D so I can get my head into that kit. If something does come up and it requires a T4D in the short term, that's great. Otherwise, I say, want to get down into those videos. So what's going to happen in this video? I'm going to briefly discuss the point that was raised in the last video about the length and duration of my videos. It has come up previously. This will probably, it won't be the last time that's raised, but I don't want to harp on by too much, but we'll just cover that off in this video. I'm going to give you a tour of the lab and the kit that has arrived. I've made some adjustments to the bench, which make it far more functional, thanks to Eve up in Canada, who spotted a very quick and simple solution, which I implemented over the weekend. I'll then show you the few bits and pieces, the kit that has arrived. We're also then going to, at the end of the video, I'm going to quickly revisit the kind of capacitor measurements on the oscilloscope, just to show you some very handy tips that I got. I'm going to refer to another channel and just give a quick overview and test of the Unity UT612 LCR meter. It's not, by all means, not going to be a full review because, as I said, I really do want to have a good precision LCR meter, which I'm hoping to get from RS Components in the near future, because ultimately I want a few references and good capacitors I can use when I'm doing this equipment. But anyway, we'll have a look at that on the bench. Right, so let's just quickly chat about the point that was raised by the gent who said that the video seemed a bit long and what have you. And then someone raised a point that, you know, if you're going to fast forward the videos at there and your analytics on your videos don't look good if people are jumping through them. So ultimately, the videos are the length they are because that's just the way I do them. I know there are quite a few folks out there who gain value because they are very new to this. There are little bits and pieces all through the video that they pick up on. If I tried to do a quick rush condensed thing, there'd be a lot of information which would be left out, and it's just not the way that I do things. Ultimately, this isn't like a quick fix, instant coffee kind of place to come and view videos. As I've always said, you're coming along with me for the ride, with you for the adventure in terms of my knowledge growth and understanding what I'm playing with. So often the videos can be longer and sometimes drawn out. I can certainly put a finger on, there are a few of my videos where when I've gone back and looked to them, I've gone, ugh. The amount of information that was in them for the duration was not right. But there's only a few that I can put a finger on like that. So, if you are after those quick fix videos, my channel is not for you. There are two solutions for that. For one, you can either fast forward. If it messes up my analytics, it doesn't matter. I'm not trying to cater for necessarily all the masses out there. If I can provide information which caters for a few people and it gives them value, then I'm a happy man. You can either fast forward through the videos, or if you find it that frustrating, don't watch them. Honestly, do yourself a favor, unsubscribe, and go and find a channel which has shorter, more concise videos. In that regard, in terms of videos which kind of do provide information in a very good short concise method, I'm going to refer you to Alan's channel. Now, I'm just looking to get his name. His call sign is W2EW, so it's Whiskey to Echo Whiskey. That's the name of his YouTube channel, and the gent who runs it is Alan, and he's a brilliant gent. I've been referred to him by one of you before when I was struggling with some fundamentals on the oscilloscope. He does a lot of tutorials and what have you related to oscilloscopes and electronics. He is far wiser than I am, and hence that's why he can put together a fairly concise video in terms of showing his examples and tutorials. And I would say to all my viewers, if you haven't yet gone, at least had a look at his channel, go and have a look, because you may really find it's worthwhile subscribing to his work. He really does an excellent job. Right, so let's move on to the other bits and pieces. And in terms of the previous video where I was obviously doing the measurements on the capacitors, thanks for a whole lot of valuable feedback, especially to Tian back in South Africa who gave me a whole lot of handy tips and information, some of which I'm going to show at the end of this video. Certainly, and the one thing which was also picked out was when I was using my calculator, the mode I was using it in. Now, when I was going through those calculations, I particularly was kind of going through to help people, show them the kind of placing of the decimals, whether it is milli, micro, nano. But when you're doing those calculations and you're not using either a scientific or engineering notation, it can get rather flustering, and you can easily make mistakes trying to decipher the long numbers with loads of zeros or what have you. Now, scientific notation is perhaps not the best mode, because it's going to round to, let's say, an exponential or an odd exponential of, let's say, minus 11, minus 13, minus 4, which is fine if you're doing scientific work. That number then is meaningful. But if you're doing engineering work, i.e. electronics, where you kind of either work in kilo, mega, giga, or milli, micro, nano, then you want it to show a notation which goes to the three significant digits. So either minus 3, minus 6, minus 9, or plus 3, and that's where the engineering mode on a calculator is particularly handy, and I'll start using that from now on. I will do a little tutorial on my other channel, Vblog Mag, in time to come, just to explain all the ins and outs of that. It can be a catch and rather frustrating for people who are new to doing electronics and working with that kind of mathematics. If they've got a calculator and they've suddenly got this either long complicated number, or it's shown in a notation which isn't understood, it can sometimes frustrate folks and throw them off the path there. Right, then I also just want to give a big thanks to, I have received a few bits and pieces in my PO box already, and I'm just about to show you some of those. But there was a good gent, Frank, who sent me a handwritten letter, and he was apologizing because his printer didn't work. And Frank, you certainly don't have to apologize, because in this day and age, handwritten messages are few and far between. So I really appreciate that. And the fact that he sent me a rather helpful little device, which I still need to test out, and hopefully I'll show you in a future video. Just to note, if you do send me something to my PO box, I know obviously most people do self-address where it's actually come from. For the most part, I'm not gonna have time to write back and do snail mail back to you. Please include your email address, because I do want to acknowledge and thank you if you do send me something. But Frank, certainly, thank you very much for that. I appreciate it. Right, so let's go and have a look at what's going on in the lab for the last time, so I can give you the lowdown of what's going on before we get stuck into equipment reviews and tutorials. Right, so where do I start? Because there's a whole heap of bits and pieces to show you. What I'll do first, I'm going to take you behind the bench. You'll see, obviously, from the previous videos, you'll have noted that I've gone and removed one of the lower pegboards, and I've now got an extension out of the back of the bench. And again, thanks to Eve, it has freed up a huge amount of space on my bench. So I have, even though it's as cluttered as it is, it has freed up a huge amount. So at least the instrumentation and what have you can be pushed back to allow more workspace in front. I was getting worried that literally I wouldn't be able to get any more equipment on the bench, but now I've literally got a fair bit of space to add a bit more equipment as it comes in. How that's worked basically is all I've done is at the back of the actual benches. Again, Eve just sent me a nice diagram and just a very quick, easy fix, because he got the kind of diagrams out for this bench and made measurements and knew what angle would fit. So I've literally got a 4 foot by 1 foot MDF shelf over there times two, and these angles which have bolted in nicely to the back of the bench. I've had to obviously drill holes exactly where the bolts were for the bench, but that's worked out. And then I've added the power strip under there so that the equipment cables come off the back. They're not tangled, they're not in the way, and plug into that power strip under there. And quite handily, almost by design, The uprights here forced a gap between the actual original bench and this extension, and that means that any cables which may come from other equipment can go down the slot and not clutter up the kind of back. So really, really handy. Right, so let's go to the other kind of bits and pieces. Now, you'll recall I mentioned in the start of the video that I was going to get a cooler for one that was going to act for as kind of my testing oven. So I wanted to be able to test various equipment, whether it's components or measurement equipment or references, at a cool temperature and then at a higher temperature. In South Africa, I had that kind of cheap cooler box, which I got guidance from to change the Peltier element, to change it from, to switch it between cooling and heating. But it took literally, to do a test in there, it would take hours to actually cool it down. And the heating would happen relatively quickly, but still, from the cold temperature, it would take me probably 6 hours just to demonstrate something at a cool temperature and then at a high temperature. So I've got this wine cooler, quite a handy little wine cooler. It's also kind of thermoelectric, got a Peltier element in it. It's got these touch controls on the actual front door, as you can see. And you can set the temperature over here in Fahrenheit. I've got it set down to, its minimum is 46. So that's the setting. But you can see it's at the moment sitting at 47. I have got a temperature cable going in there, so that's slightly breaking the seal. But otherwise, I think this could be really handy. So this seems to be working well. I'm going to come back to the safe over there. But what I wanted to show you is I found this again on Amazon. I've been looking for a really handy temperature data logger. And for the most part, you do get ones with either 3 or 4 inputs. Some of them have SD cards, which is handy. This one doesn't, but it does download via USB to a PC. And it can store thousands of readings. And depending on the number of channels you're using, depends on the length of time. You can obviously set the interval, anything from like a second to hours. So this can data log for months. It's got pin-like batteries in it. It'll last for a year switched on, or even up to like 6 years if it goes into its sleep and kind of off mode. Now the really handy thing is that it's got 4 channels. The one is the internal T0, or the first temperature is the internal temperature, which is obviously just giving the ambient. It's then got 3 other channels, temp 1, 2, and 3. 3 I've actually got monitoring that fridge at the moment, which is quite handy. So here it's within nice eye shot of me at my bench. I can see what's happening down in that little wine cooler. And I've got 2 temperature probes placed inside the safe, so I can monitor what's going on in there as well. And in the different views, I'll just show you, it gives you kind of a difference between the different temperatures. It shows you the kind of log rate at the moment. I'm actually logging it every 30 seconds, the number of samples I've collected so far, the memory that's been used, the memory that's left. You can then show what you want to graph. You can graph 2 channels at a time, and that was a neat feature about this little temperature logger. When you go here, you can see it's actually got a little graphical graph. On this side, it shows that's T0, and it shows you the temperature range for T0 as a solid line. And here's T3 that I've selected to show, and it's obviously sitting in a lower range from 7 degrees to 9 degrees Celsius is what I've got it set at. And you can go back in time, so if I push this back, you've got time and date stamps and the period that it's showing you for. So I can actually step back and show what was going on. And as you can see, the ambient temperature, and that's obviously the AC unit which is coming on, so there's a bit of hysteresis there as things warm up, the AC unit comes on and comes down. So for all kinds of work, this little unit could be really handy. I think I'll certainly add this to my Amazon store, and I'll probably put a link below, but very, very nice. Right, so then I say I've got all the equipment pushed back off eBay. I got this Decade capacitor box, which again will be up for review. What I really like about this device, it was made and used in the 70s, kind of the decade I was born in. The case itself is Bakelite, if I'm not mistaken. So remember telephones when plastic kind of wasn't really mainstream around that time? Bakelite was the in thing. Now Bakelite obviously is hard and fairly fragile, it can crack if it's dropped. And what I also like on these, and there's loads of these on eBay at a reasonable price, but it's actually got the tester who went and checked it, the kind of calibration chart here, where they've actually handwritten in the actual noted values for what's on the top. It hasn't got a huge range. It's kind of in microfarads, and as you can see, it's got from zero going up in tenths to 1 microfarad, and then down to a second place after the comma, basically 4 microfarads. But nonetheless, I put it on the scope and it seems to work 100%. I then have I've gone and ordered a few capacitors, air capacitors, and these are mainly from kind of the older era, although they are still made, but ham radio and what have ham radio enthusiasts would in particular find these handy. And again, this is all preparation for kind of setting up reference capacitors and for the tutorial on capacitors. So I'll have a look at those. Some of them are quite old. In fact, again, this one came off eBay. Another set, more trimmer capacitors. This equipment, thanks to the gent, I had one of these in South Africa. So these are these Effigy electricity meters, which can show you your instantaneous power and also measure consumption and log it to a PC. So the agent for these, I don't know whether it's for, he's the agent for America or a local agent, but he sent me an email and said, you know, you'd like to send me this kit for review. So I hope when time allows, I'll set one of these Effigy units up. The new part of it is they've got a unit that will transmit the data to the internet. So that's different from what I had before. So I'll be pulling this out, trying to see how easy it is to set up, and then I'll do a quick demonstration video on that. I've then also got this more modern decade capacitance box. Again, if you go onto eBay, you'll see these are fairly easily available. They are the cheaper end. It's only got an accuracy of down to like 0.5%. However, at this point in time, that's kind of the range I'm playing in. So it's it basically you set the values by flicking the switches up and then flicking them down. I know it's not the best one, and in time I will get one of the better ones. But again, when you're just doing a fun bit of experimenting, want to play with capacitance values, that's quite a handy little device, and we'll certainly have a look at that as well. And then what also arrived from eBay was this, and I mentioned this would be coming, was this Buchel, it's Buchel Scientific, if I've got the name, mentioned the name correctly. And this is their Tropicooler. Now this is used for, in the kind of medical industry for the most part. As I noted, these retail new apparently for around $3,000. I've seen cheaper units on Amazon for around $1,800. This I paid $50 for. Now, it's an interesting unit in that it's specifically designed for cooling samples inside little test tubes. What is missing is like you have a cover that goes on the top here to kind of form the seal over this area, which can either be heated or cooled. And you have little aluminium blocks where your test tubes sit in. Now that's fairly critical to the way this works, because there is no fan blowing the air around. It's this aluminium base inside here which cools down and would conduct either the heat or the cooling to those tubes. But I wanted one of these just for fun, just so I could put, if I wanted to put references or components in here for testing. This one should in theory go to minus 19 degrees Celsius and plus 69. I noted on eBay when I purchased this, and I mentioned that it had this warning on here about only use between 15 and 50, and this device unfortunately only just manages to get down to about 15 degrees Celsius and gets about 55. So this is going to be a project that we're going to open up. We're going to have a look inside. It does need a good dust out and clean inside, and we'll see. Perhaps I think it's also got one of those Peltier thermoelectric units which actually does the heating and the cooling. So we'll have a look and see if we can perhaps fix it, or if there's it's something I can replace. Nice operation. You kind of set the temperatures. It obviously measures down to a tenth of a degree, but you can set it to per degree, and it seems to be fairly accurate. So this may be handy even for either calibrating or actually checking thermal devices, like measurement devices like the Fluke I've got, because I was using that to measure the temperature in here, and it's giving a very close value here. So it means I can set a certain temperature and see how a measurement device is doing according to that. May need a little bit of calibration, but nonetheless, that's something we'll come up to. Right, another device that has arrived is this Mastek MS5203 digital insulation tester. Now, on the way, either today or tomorrow, I'm going to get the Fluke. I think it's the 1587, if I recall correctly. Now, I did some reading last night, and for those of you who haven't or may not know a lot about insulation testing, I'm going to do a video before I do reviews on these pieces of equipment about what is an insulation tester and how to do insulation testing. It's going to be theoretical because I've not done a lot of this myself. I'm going to do some practical testing beforehand, but there certainly is more of an art and science to doing this. It's not a case of straightforward hooking this up to circuit, pushing a button, getting a resistance reading and understanding whether your insulation is working correctly. There's a lot more behind it. And so I'm certainly going to do a video on that, and I'll be asking for pearls of wisdom for those of you who are in the industry who do use these devices. As I said, it's very interesting. If you don't know much about these, and potentially there's a lot of us folk who don't work in this area who don't, then that could be quite interesting. But I say, there's this device, which is a cheaper item, obviously a more value entry item, and then the Fluke. And we'll do a comparison to see the pros and cons between how these all work. Right, and as you all know, I have an interest in energy storage devices, and in particularly supercapacitors. So I showed you in the previous video that I had that boost cap, and that boost cap had a value of 350 farads. Now, I went further hunting and I came across this boost cap, which has got a rating of 1,500 farads. It's a 2.7 volt unit. And as I said, these devices are potentially going to be very interesting for the future in terms of hybrid vehicles and storing eco power, whether it's from wind power or solar power. I think these potentially are going to play a big role. Now, I hadn't realized this company Maxwell seemed to be one of the leaders in this kind of industry and in terms of these type of capacitors. Worthwhile going to have a look at their site. They have a lot of interesting information. As I noted, that 350 farad capacitor, if it was shorted, can produce about 840 amps. This is actually designed to produce up to 1,200 amps for a very brief second, but it can sustain very high current output and be charged at a high output. So I've already kind of on my setup over there, I've got my two manometers. I've got my PC set up there, and I've started data logging the energy density of these devices again, and that's another video that'll come up. What I'm hoping to do is, the reason I've got my Precision Manuo power supply there is that these two should be able to interact, so they can act as triggers for each other. So that if I want to, again, cycle batteries and test the cycling of batteries before Manuo bring out the M66 series, hopefully these two together can do that. Now, the one interesting thing is I also got the second-hand boost cap. This is a 2,600 farad unit, and it's second-hand. Now, the really interesting thing about this is this came out of, according to the eBay seller, it came out of a hybrid bus. Now, this ultimately wouldn't have been used to power the bus itself, but it would have been used when they for regenerative braking. So basically, when the bus applies its brakes, power is applied, is then sent into these, and then when the bus pulls off, and that's potentially when you're going to use a lot of energy, gets wasted moving the mass of the bus, then it pulls that energy from these until it gets up to a sustained speed when less energy is required to keep the bus at a kind of constant speed. So again, very interesting the background of where this comes from, and I wanted to see
how well one of these would have survived in terms of if it's been in a harsh environment and cycled multiple times. So that's my testing on this, is to see how well it's actually done coming out of an installation like that. So again, that'll be up in the testing. And then I did say that I would be demonstrate my own DIY electronic DC load in that testing, and I connected it up, and naughty me, because I didn't label it, I connected it up to my metrics multimeter incorrectly, and blue smoke. Oh, anyway, so that's something I'll probably do. I'm not going to bore you guys with me taking apart to find the fault. The blue smoke came out the top, so it'll be on that little PC board. I have to find what I've blown and fix that. But once I've got it fixed, again, I'll demonstrate that with what I was doing with the kind of energy storage devices. Right, then what's cooking below my bench? This is part of it. This is a very handy, it's a digital thermostat device which can basically control heating and cooling. It's got two relays which you can either, you can set to click in at a certain temperature to either produce heat or to cool, with some hysteresis built into it so that you haven't got something constantly going on and off. And that's going to be part of the project in terms of the safe below. And basically the reason I built the safe, you can see now I have tiled it, so I've got kind of a ceramic base. It's just something that I wanted to do. But as I'm going to do unattended battery cycling, I wanted it to be as safe as possible. So what I've done, I've got this safe, I've drilled some holes in and got some grommets so I can get wiring into it. The idea is that I can shut the door on it when I've got a battery in there, and it should anything go awry, at least there's some containment. Now what's the, there are a couple additions. I've got a smoke alarm and carbon monoxide alarm, which I'm going to place either literally just above it or in the room somewhere. I've actually got a tester. I'm actually going to put smoke in here and test how well this all works. I've also got a fire suppression system coming in, and that I certainly will show you. It was developed by an American guy. Now, fire suppression systems can be very expensive, but this one is fairly simple. It's basically a fire extinguisher bottle with a tube that comes out, and he basically designed it for clothes dryers because the lint buildup can sometimes cause quite a few fires in the States. So you merely put this tube into the back of your clothes dryer, and if there's a fire, the fire actually ruptures the tube and then sprays a patented fire suppressant through the enclosed area. It wouldn't work in an open area, but in an enclosed space, which this is, obviously it's perfect. So all I need to do is put the tube in. I'll route it across the top here and down here. So if anything went awry, then basically the kind of fire suppression agent would be released and kind of take hold of whatever's in here. As noted before, I generally do have a lot of not expecting anything to go awry. I'm not trying to do anything dangerous. I am just a little more overcautious about fire because I have both been inside a car. I crashed a car in my youth by mistake, he says, but I had a car accident and the car caught fire. I was caught inside the car while it was on fire, which wasn't a pleasant experience. Also, in my youth, unfortunately, someone attempted to murder someone, or they did actually murder a couple of people in the house we were living in when I was younger, and they set a room on fire, so I was in a house that was on fire as well. So I tend to have a little thing about fire, so I tend to have fire extinguishers spread around the place, but in particular because I'm doing this work, hence why I'm going to this level. I certainly don't expect any issue from normal batteries, so there's kind of, this is probably really over the top, but nonetheless, I am going to be testing lithium technologies. So that's in particular why I've got this. I don't intend leaving lithium technologies unattended for a long time, but this is just belts and braces for that. I'll actually spin this around just to show you the setup at the back to give you an idea of how it works. Right, so I'll have to excuse with it pulled out there a few wires which are a little bit of a challenge, but basically what I did, I drilled the holes in the back over there so that I, and put grommets in them so at least the wiring doesn't get shredded by the metal. That's a temperature probe going in there, and then a temperature probe going in the bottom here. I've got an air intake over there, passive. There's no fan on that one, but a little filter just to help with removing some of the dust that would go into this. And that then pulls through, and then I've got this mains or 110, 120 volt fan, which is on a variable speed control. So I can control the speed of that, and that's because I've got batteries in an enclosed space. If there happens to be any gas buildup, which I don't expect, but nonetheless, then at least I've got air cycling to remove the air that any gases build up from inside the actual safe itself. And then I said, what I'll do, I'll have an additional hole where that kind of fire suppression system will actually go into the actual safe itself and loop through both the top and the bottom. Right, so one other thing I didn't want to skip by, I again found this on Amazon, was a personal little heater. It's a ceramic heater. And it does produce a rather nice little bit of heat when it's actually put on. I can actually see this actually being quite useful if you wanted localized heating without a big heating system. But this would be, I'm going to set up on that kind of thermostatic controller as the heating side. And I've got a couple of choices. I can either set it up in the safe. I can kind of remove the battery testing and have have this blowing air in, kind of the air intake at the bottom, with a thermostatically controlled temperature probe inside to switch it on and off as needed. Or I could set it up inside the cooler, but as I said, that's going to kind of extend the time. So if I want to do kind of temperature coefficient testing, I can then take out the cooler and put inside the safe, if that's what I'm going to use kind of as the kind of oven, so that I've got a quick turnaround in terms of doing the testing. Yes, there could be issues with thermal shock doing that kind of thing, but I say that's a bridge I'll cross as I start to play in that area. This was the kind of, it's a talking fire smoke monitor and carbon monoxide alarm. And I've brought an aerosol to check. I'm going to spray the aerosol inside the safe, see where the smoke escapes, and see where the best placement of this device will be. So that'd be another bit of testing I actually go through and do. Right, so let's get down and have a brief overview and quick look at this Unity UT612. Now again, a big thanks to Barry of tester.co.uk for putting this into my hands. I will place a link to his website, so if you want to go and have a look at pricing and what have you, then certainly you can go and do that. In this exercise, what we're going to do, we're going to do a few capacitor measurements with it and a few resistor measurements and do a comparison against my Fluke 8646A with a set of Kelvin clips, and then compare measurements on my Agilent oscilloscope. Now what this will also highlight, and again that's why I've kind of taken so much time to get to the point where I can do confident reviews of these meters, is that in particular when we start doing the measurements on the scope, as noted when I was trying to do the measurement of that really low value capacitor, that picofarad capacitor, there potentially, once you start getting down to levels like that, there are loads of things which can influence a result and a reading. There can be capacitance in the probes of the actual oscilloscopes, and it's noted on the front of my scope that there's at least 11 picofarad in the probes themselves. So besides capacitance, inductance, and stray resistance, which can affect measurements. So that's why it can be a real challenge measuring those things. It's why I want to have a good precision LCR meter on the bench. It'll be a good test because a good precision LCR meter apparently can go down to the low picofarad measurements and do it accurately. But at least by having the scope and the function generator, I now have a few points of reference to quite try and weigh up how accurate things are, and then to, as I said, to try and get some good reference capacitors. Capacitors generally have a tolerance of anywhere between 5, 10 or greater percent. Their capacitance is going to vary under various conditions, environmental, temperature, humidity, and in particular the frequency that they used at. So there are a whole lot of variables which need to be accounted for. But anyway, let's just quickly have a quick look at this and see how it compares to what the scope shows on this, and obviously in resistance measurements. Right, so this, the UT612 does come in this nice case, hard kind of plastic case to protect it. It does come with the set of surface mount tweezers, so that if you've got surface mount capacitors and what have you, then you can use these for your testing. It's obviously got some software because it's got a USB connection. You can obviously log data and what have you to the actual PC itself and the USB cable. It comes with, it's got this device in here, so you can obviously either use the probes inside the unit like that, or you can have this plugged in and simply plug in your resistors and capacitors in here, which is really nice because you've got a shorter lead and thus less chance of either voltage drops or capacitance in the leads themselves. So this is a nice way to actually do put the devices in and take measurements. It then does come with a manual, which of course, unfortunately, again with Unity, the manuals are not the best in terms of the kind of translation from Chinese. It's okay, but not the best. This meter in particular, once you start looking at it, I'll just note some of the key features that it's obviously measures up to about 20,000 count on the main display, and it's got a secondary display as well. It tests at 100 Hz, 120, 1 kHz, 10 kHz, and 100 kHz. Now for the testing here, just so that we don't run too long, I'm going to do most of the testing probably either the low end, 100 Hz, or 1 kHz. And 1 kHz tends to be the main standard or one of the reference frequencies that a lot of capacitive testing is done at. Now again, if you want to understand a lot of the terms in terms of the different measurement modes, you can measure capacitors in equivalent series or equivalent parallel circuits. You've then got obviously equivalent series resistance, you've got your loss factor, quality factor, phase location, and I talk about all these in the first review I did of Frankie's Mustek LCR meter. So certainly if you want to get a kind of layman's interpretation of that and understanding, then again I'll link to that video and you can go and watch that just to get the first part of the video, just to get an understanding. So I say this is the guide, and then in here it quotes, it does have a sorting feature, which when I do the full review, as noted with the Mustek meter as well, you can kind of set parameters. And if you're doing a project and you want capacitors which are, let's say, within 5% of their rated capacity, you can set that tolerance and then pass the capacitors through the meter and get a pass or fail whether they meet that criteria. So a nice, quick, easy sorting facility. So, and it does that. And again, in the full review, I'll actually show that facility. Another thing I just want to highlight is that on meters like these, and again, it does do inductors. I don't have any inductors here yet. My kit is about to arrive, so I will have that soon. But on this, in terms of the accuracy, it is quoting for the most part, and I'll just note, anywhere between on the kind of lower values of 2% plus 5 counts down to 0.5% plus 5 counts. Now on the top end meters, you're looking at either 0.1% or 0.05% or around that area. And that's the kind of region, the kind of accuracy figures that I'm after to try and get a good reference in terms of this testing. As you can see, a lot of these meters, as noted, they don't go down to very low measurements. This one, I believe, let's just check. Right, so this one, in terms of the kind of range and precision, noted here, you can see the inductance values from 20 millihenries to 2000 henries, capacitors, 200 picofarad to 20 millifarad. Now, I was obviously trying to measure a capacitor way lower than that, and you kind of said, you kind of now realize and respect the challenges with measuring those low capacitance values. And again, the high-end meters apparently do. So that's one thing I'm intrigued to see, is how well those high-end meters fare in that kind of area. And in terms of resistance, from 20 ohms to 200 mega ohms. So let's power it on and have a quick look. Right then, so we have the meter, and literally the power on button is this kind of orangey-yellow button over here. It powers up, and by default, it goes to the kind of default test mode of 1 kHz for testing devices. For it can obviously test devices at a frequency, or it can do a DC test, for instance, on resistors as well. All you need to do is take your device under test, let's say your capacitor. Now this happens to be a 0.22 microfarad capacitor, and you simply slip it in here, and it will auto detect whether it is a capacitor, an inductor, or a resistor for the most part. Sometimes when the values are a bit tricky, you can then go into this function button will switch between the different modes, so you can go and select. And depending on the value, as noted, I talk about when I reviewed the MusTech, it will decide whether it's going to do a series equivalent or parallel equivalent measurement of that device under test. So as you can see here, it's come up very quickly and noted the value in nanofarad. So as I said, if you move the comma three places to the left, we're then going to get to microfarad, and that would come fairly close to its rating of 0.22 microfarad. And then on your secondary display, it defaults to the loss factor, which is a D, and you can switch between your Q, or your quality factor, your equivalent series resistance, your ESR, which is probably one of the more important, well, I say one of the more important ones. It depends on your application. But certainly what I'm going to highlight when I start putting the scope on is how that can play a part when you're doing measurements and understanding how a capacitor can affect a circuit. So the ESR, very handy, it's got it there. And then obviously your theta, your phase angle of the capacitor. So let's go through, we'll start off by doing a measurement of some resistors and comparing them against the Fluke. Right, so some fun camera angles again. Hopefully everything will be clear enough to kind of note what's going on. This Unity, and I've got it lying down here, and I kind of, as I was setting up the shot, realized that it's quite handy to see the kind of angle is quite low on the standing bale. It doesn't feel the most secure on that standing bale, it has to be said. These are things I will pick up in the full review, but for this little camera exercise, it kind of works fine, because you can see, compare the values on the 2 meters themselves. Just as a note, these are priced anywhere between $140 and about $180, depending on where you find them. As I said, down below I will place a link. If you want to support my sponsor, then by all means go to tester.co.uk, but that's kind of the price range you'll find it on. Right, so the first resistor value I'm going to check, and I'm not going to check, we're going to check three. I don't want to check really high values because they're not going to really give us an idea on accuracy. So this is a 33K resistor over here. Now, as I said, I've got the Kelvin clips, I've got my Fluke set up for 4-wire measurement, and if I place that in there and remove my fingers, you'll see on the Fluke in the background there that it's showing 32.96. Let's see what the Unity comes up with. Right, so I've gone and placed it in here, and I, through my changing the kind of modes on here, went out of the normal automatic mode. So I'm going to put it back in there, and as you can see, it's come up with 32.98. So certainly can't complain about that reading, very close to what my Fluke is doing. And as I said, because you got it right there, you negate a lot of the potential losses you get with having leads, because of the losses in leads with that little device in there. Let's go for something a little smaller. Right, I've now got a 390 ohm resistor, and if we have a look at the back, you can see it's actually measuring 0.387. So 0.387K. So let's see how close that is on the Unity. And here we go. Down, I think it was a 7 on the Fluke down here. So again, and there we go, it's just twitched up to that. So in terms of its resistance measurement, it certainly seems to be doing a very good job. Right, and to really test its metal, I've got a 1.8 ohm resistor. So I mean, I know my Fluke is going to go probably down to quite a few places when measuring this. So there we go, it's showing 1.79. We'll take 1.791. And here we go. It certainly is a few counts out at this level, but it's a very low resistance value. So I'm sure certainly within its stated accuracy, it's still there because of the value that we add. Let's pop over onto the capacitors and see how well it does there. Right then, so before we hop over to the capacitors, something I want to highlight that caught me out that I wasn't checking. I was checking it was automatically checking the resistors at a frequency. Now, for the most part, you saw they certainly weren't far off what the Fluke was doing, but the Fluke's doing a DC test on them, it's not supplying an AC signal. So for this last capacitor, the 1.1 that's noted at 1.8, I switched over to DC resistance test, and as you can see, it's come up with a far better value. So certainly, again, that's something to note. You want to be aware of the type of signal that you're feeding your device under test, because obviously the results will vary, and I was caught by that. But there you go, certainly a good result for what it's measuring there. Certainly doesn't have quite the resolution, but nonetheless at this level, not too bad. Right here, so I've kind of set up hopefully to avoid too much reflection and light on the screen. Apologies, there is a little bit there. I've got the function generator configured with a square wave at 1 kHz, 1 volt peak to peak. I've got, for this test, we've got a 1.5 nanofarad capacitor. I'm not going to go into picofarad measurements, as I said, because of the challenges with doing that at this point in time. I have also, with suggestion, I haven't got the device under test in a breadboard, because Kibi, thank you very much, mentioned there could be capacitance there, and I've just got it literally inside the probes. The probes are gripping the legs for the test. Now, again, hats off to, and this is both to Tian, I said the gent in South Africa, he was a gent who showed me, brought attention to the Siglent oscilloscope fix for my Zitron scope, and he does lots of contributions. He's got a great website. And he pointed this out to me, and this also comes from Alan's channel that I mentioned earlier. On my scope, I can set the measurement cursors to automatically pick up certain points. So it acts like a caliper. Automatically, I've told it to go through to the kind of 63.2% mark of the wave. Now, if you go and set that up, it obviously retains that for the signal that's coming in. If you scale it correctly in your oscilloscope so that it can take the reading nicely, and you use a nice reference resistance value, you can virtually directly read off the screen the value of the capacitor. So that's what I wanted to show. So once, because I'm using the 1K a resistor, and I've got this measurement set up the way I have. Now, when I insert a capacitor, the time noted here, so it's got the rise time, which is obviously this time over here that it's measuring, is noted as 1.3 microseconds, and that directly translates to nanofarad, as it turns out. I'll show you the calculation on a calculator, but basically this is saying, and if we, a single shot is a far better way to do this. If I do a few single shots, you can see we're sitting at around the 1.31, 1.34 measurement for this capacitor. And at a single shot, I say, you then get this nice reading out here. So if we get the calculator and actually do the maths, if I go and take the time, so remember we've got to do time over resistance, so 1.3, and that's microseconds, so that's 1.3 raised to the 10 to the minus 6, or exponential, and that is going to be over 1,000 ohm, or 1K, and we go equals on that. We now get, in a nice engineering format, 1.3 nanofarad. So that's very close to the actual stated value. So let's see what I didn't do. I didn't include the actual 4. So I should actually go and edit that. So the answer is probably obvious, but because we've got the extra digit on the actual scope itself, let's at least go to that. So we've got the 1.34 nanofarad. So we're going to pop this into the LCR, the Unity LCR meter, and see what it produces. Right, so here we go. I've gone and stuck that very same capacitor, the one point, which is noted as 1.5 nanofarad. And again, it's showing a value in pico, but obviously if we move the comma three places, and this is showing 1.46, which is closer than the actual scope is showing it. However, as we'll see in later examples, there are a few things we need to take into account. This has obviously got an error in accuracy, which potentially could change this figure, the 4, by two places, which would put it in the realms of what we're seeing on the scope here, and obviously the noted value. Also, there's potential equivalent series resistance in the capacitor itself that can be playing a part. Let's get on to the next measurement. Right, so the next capacitor I've actually gone and placed into the kind of probes and what have you, and this should give you a hint. I've placed a 47 nanofarad. And again, due to the way this has all been set up, we're almost reading directly. If we just take a single shot, it's sitting around either the 40, high 48 values or the 49s. Now, if I go and place that into the actual LCR meter itself, so here we go. I've got the capacitor in there. And if we go and have a look at the reading, and again, you'll note the frequency is the same that I'm testing at. It's saying 48.62. which is certainly very close, bearing in mind the kind of accuracy rating and tolerance on the capacitor to what I'm getting on the scope. And as I said, through this exercise, what I'm trying to establish is that I've got a few points of reference now so that I can double check these capacitors. And I must say, again, I'm really impressed by what you can do with a function generator and an oscilloscope to kind of get readings like this. Right, so now I've gone and inserted an electrolytic capacitor, and this will bring up quite a few interesting issues. So this electrolytic is rated at 2.2 microfarad. Now, as you'll note, obviously I'm not getting the direct readings. I don't really have a nice curve, charge curve. At this point in time, I've got no resistance dialed in. If I dial in the kind of 1K, then it's too high. Even if I go tens of ohms, you can see we're not getting a nice wave. So here we're falling victim to the frequency. This is where I've been caught off guard before, because obviously capacitors react differently at different frequencies, and this electrolytic at 1000 hertz is obviously not giving us a nice signal out. So I'm going to drop it to 100 hertz. And we'll have a look at that signal. I've got dialed in at the moment 10 ohm. So let's just see that we do get a nicely scaled signal for that. Right, so what I'm going to do, I'm playing around the resistance, and I'm going to dial in, I've tried 10 ohm, but on the 100 ohm setting, I seem to get a nice signal that's coming through. So I'm gonna take a snapshot of that. Now you'll see we've got the 286.4. That's still not really giving us an exact reading by all accounts. So let's just quickly do the calculation on that. So if I go 286 to the negative 6, which is our time, so 286 microseconds divided by, and I've got 100 ohm dialed in, equals, whoops. So we've got 2.86 microfarad. Now we should be at 2.2. So what's the problem? So as I said, first of all, obviously the frequency was a challenge. And let me just show you. So what I've done, I've gone and taken a measurement with that capacitor, and I've gone and held the value. I've gone and taken out, put it in here, and I've got it back in the scope. But the important, and you can see the reading on the LCR meter is far closer to what it should be. So where have I gone wrong? I've gone and set this to go and look at the equivalent series resistance. And as you can note, there's 26.4 ohm in ESR, which is certainly going to affect the reading. So let's do the calculation again, including that equivalent series resistance. So I'm just going to go and edit that, add in the 26, and then go equals, and then what are we getting? 2.27. On here we're getting 2.1, but with the tolerances and potential other resistance which might be playing a part, we're certainly not far off the 2.2, which is what we're looking for. So basically with that exercise, I just wanted to highlight again that obviously the scope, when you've got all these measurement facilities set up, can be really handy to actually read off and get a measurement of a capacitor. The Unity UT61 or 612 certainly seems to be doing fairly well. But as you can see, there are some interesting challenges that you do face by doing these measurements. This is something I do want to cover off when I do the full review and I've got a reference LCR meter.
Right, so hopefully you found that interesting. As you realize, there certainly are quite a few little bits and pieces that can trip you up in terms of doing those kinds of measurements on the oscilloscope or even on a meter like this. When you're sitting and changing the frequencies that you measure at, they, for certain capacitors, things go way off. But that is something I say, I'm kind of bumbling my way through and finding out and learning as I go along. And that's why I say the nice, good, high-precision reference LCR meter should help with that. But anyway, thank you for your patience if you managed to reach this point in the video. As I said, feel free to fast forward. If you get frustrated with the way I do my videos, then certainly unsubscribe, find a channel which obviously does short, concise videos rather than frustrating yourself. As you can see, there is a lot of equipment to get through, so I'm going to get my head down into doing those reviews, tutorials, and fun little experiments and what have you. And we'll certainly have a little bit of a slow up on the T4D, so I can do that. But anyway, thanks very much for following me, and I'll catch you very soon for the next video. Cheers.
Tester.co.uk